So we are in the last and final module, final topic of e-section or series for this subject, which is electrical services and illumination. Today in module 5, subheading 2. So for the load estimation, we will have to make a plan first. So I'll make a residential. It also says load electrical layout design. We need to have the syllabus says for a residence. So we'll have to make a plan first, and from then we'll have to move on to the load estimation. So let me just quickly make a plan. Guys, don't mind if the line is not straight, okay? I have drawn a residential plan here. Let us say this is going to be the living, kitchen come dining, prayer room, bedroom with an attached toilet, balcony kind of a space, another bedroom, common toilet, a powder room, staircase, right? Okay, so this is the residence that we have taken as an example to do the electrical layout. So with all that we know, so when we enter right from this point, so what do you think do we need? So one is we will probably need a light here. One is that we will need a light here as we enter, and depending upon the arrangement, this is the representation for a ceiling fan. We would probably need another ceiling fan here, another ceiling fan here, and maybe one more here. In terms of your lighting, we would probably need a light here, a light here, a light here, a light here, and even one or two lights in the outdoor, right? And let's say this is the platform. And this is where, let's say, our refrigerator is, right? So this is going to be your stove. Let's say we have the sink over here. So this is our refrigerator, and we can even have extend this counter where we have our microwave oven, induction top, mixer and all that, right? And over here we will again need a light and again in the puja we will be needing a light. In bedroom we will need, if this is our cot, so we'll be needing a light here. We will also be needing some light here, and in the toilet we'll again be needing a couple of lights. Right. So now we have almost planned our requirement of lights, maybe not in kitchen yet. Right. So we have almost planned the requirement of the lights here. So lights and probably the fans as well. So first thing probably that we would need when we enter the houses, we will need a calling bell. So this is a representation for a calling bell as per NBC. So we have a set of conventions which will appear here. for your reference, so this is going to be a calling bell. And ceiling fan. And we already know what is it for the lights, right? So we know this now. So now that we have located all our lights, so probably, okay, let us get into even more detail. We spoke about refrigerator, microwave oven, and induction top, and mixers and grinders, all those kitchen appliances. So in living, we will be also requiring TV. Let's say this is where our TV is going to be, so we would need a socket. So how do you represent a socket? If some of you could recall, I have drawn the convention for a socket in our lighting layout. Nevertheless, a socket, another thing that we also should remember is a socket can be of several capacity. So this socket is 6 amp socket, whereas this is 16 amp socket, and it will vary according to the need, right? So some of it, sometimes it is even represented this, right? So now let us try to locate the socket. So we are going to have a couple of sockets to which something might get connected. So let's say I'm going to put up a socket for the TV over here, and probably one more socket for the connector, and one heavy 16 amp socket also over here. And similarly, we will have to have the same thing in kitchen as well, just that all of them would be for heavy appliances, so it will be 16 amp sockets, right? And for that matter, many of the, even some of the international standards recommend not having any of the sockets inside the washroom space for obvious reasons. So we will not put anything inside the toilet, but yes, we will have a couple of sockets in the bedroom as well. When I draw a socket, it doesn't mean that it is exactly located that particular wall or particular surface. So we are just trying to figure out what each space is going to require. So probably again, a puja room can have a couple of sockets, a prayer room and dining space can also have one or two sockets. The idea of providing, as in we don't have to flood the entire house with so many sockets. When you draw 16 amp socket everywhere, it is just that sometimes in the process of cleaning our houses, we are going to use vacuum machines and it is not going to come to enough length if we have to cover the entire distance. So that is why in every nook, in every corner, wherever we feel is it is needed, we try to imagine that aspect of a vacuum cleaner and cleaning, so that we cover up the entire house with a good number of 16 amps, so that we can use such not a regular but appliances which could be used at times. Even for maintenance, somebody wants to make an additional drill hole, so you can't really take it from one end of the house to the other end of the house. So that's why we keep reserve sockets of 6 amps or 16 amps in the worst case, right? So over here, remember, I have one ceiling fan, one light, so we will have to provide a switch, one for ceiling fan, one for the light, maybe one for this, and one for the one which is inside. Similarly, 1, 2, 3, right? One to work, actually two. Similarly, one for this toilet and this one. This light probably would need to be switched on when somebody enters, ascends, and also one, this probably needs to get switched off once when somebody reaches an exit. So this is where we use something called as a two-way switch, right? So remember. And again, this would require, let's say, one for inside, one for two-way for outside, one for inside and outside. And so these three can be dependent upon the requirement. Similarly, one for these two. So again, it is the same process like our lighting layout. So when I have a switch, I'm going to connect this and this. So, and one can be for this, so one can be for this can also be for this because it's a two-way, and this is a bell, and one we will have here which is connected to this. Just that we're going to make a small difference. I would request your attention here. When I give a switch or a socket, I'm going to say, especially switch, I'm going to connect this and make an arrow further and put a arrow there, right? So if you observe from here, I connected this light, and this is again a two-way. This again connected because these two switches are used to power up, energize this light. They come here and I take them out and end that particular line with an arrow. So similarly, you have a fan here. Let me put a switch here. I'm going to take it to the fan and end that circuit with an arrow. I will tell you what this means, but this is mandatory for any and every switch that we are going to put. So this fan will go and finally it goes out. And let's say we are going to power up these both of these lights with one switch. So I'm going to take like this, and finally show that arrow. So that is called as a home run, not because of the analogy with the baseball. So this means wherever it is, the circuit has to be completed by laying a dedicated wire to the nearby circuit box, which in other terms, in this context, it's just a distribution box. So the distribution box is somewhere located outside your house. Distribution box, and that starts distributing current or power to all of this. So inside a distribution box, if we have understood our previous lectures, we will have several circuit breakers, we will have several strategies by the electrical engineer. So one will take care of, in fact, in larger complexes, commercial buildings, we will have different names. One is lighting DB, one is electrical DB, there's something called as raw power, we can even say raw power DB, one is UPS DB, one handles only the UPS battery current, right? So likewise, the DB is the one which is going to get power from the main government supply after it gets metered, and from here it goes to different locations. In a large facility, we can have a couple of DB. So let's say this is your ground floor DB, so we are going to have another DB which communicates with each other or may not communicate with each other, that is going to take care of the first floor. Or if you have a building which is like this with two wings and two corridors, so you can zone it in such a fashion. This can be your zone 1, which will be dealt with 1 dB, and this can be your zone 2, which can be dealt with some other dB. So there are several ways of strategizing this, but yes, so any connection that we make with the switch, it goes to the appliance and finally it has to go to the nearest possible dB. So by doing it, we are just trying to avoid that this extra line coming to the DB. So when by not doing this and by just doing it with ending it with an arrow, it means it has to go to the corresponding DB, right? So that is about this. So I have not covered everything. So again, there is a two-way switch, one in the ground floor, one in the first floor. We're going to connect this lamp with this, and finally from this lamp we're just going to do this. So that is the difference between a single bulb two-way switch and a one-way switch. So likewise, we just have to cover all the switches to our appliances and that's how electrical layout is completed, made, right? So by doing this, irrespective of the facility, irrespective of the size, irrespective of the load, this is how we prepare an electrical layout. And keeping this, I'm not going to erase this, let it be as it is. So we will quickly move on to how do we get to the basics of load calculation, and we complete our series of lectures, right? So now we will take this plan that we initially did and try to estimate the total load that this would require, right? So before we get in India, we have 230 volts being supplied to our households, and this entire load is going to be in wattage, right? So now let us take the spaces that we have here. Let's say the open terrace, that is, we will go in this order from where we enter, and next is going to be our let's call this as living space, and this is a workspace that we have made. Let's go to our kitchen space. And next we have our washroom, right? So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of them. And with these 5 spaces, I think we can cover the entire house, right? So in open terrace, we have 2 lights, right? So let me say lights numbers 2, right? And let us take the living. We have 1 TV, 1 number. We have 1, 2 light fixtures into 2, and fan into 1, and anything else? No, right? Okay, so we stop here. We go to the work desk. We have 1 fan, and let us add another light. And when we go to our kitchen, we have so many of them. Let's say 1 exhaust fan, 1 light, and a refrigerator, 1 oven. We have provided a socket. I'm just converting that into the appliances, and mixer, induction, right? And in the toilet, we have 1 more light. Okay. I hope we have not missed out anything. Probably, of course, we have missed out all the sockets. We will come to that. So now, which is that light that we have? Let's say we are going to have LED 18 watts. So we have 18 into 2, that becomes 36. So what I'm writing here is in watts. So we have 2 LEDs, which comes up to 36. We have 1 TV. TV these days, LED TV consumes about 50 to 80, 100. Okay, let's keep it as 60. Again, we have 2 light fixtures. We have, let's say, 36. Fan is going to consume around 60 to 75 watts. Okay, so again, 60 lighters. We will go for a brighter one. Okay, we have only 1, so with 18. Kitchen exhaust fan is going to consume let's say 55 or 60. A light, we know it is going to be 18. Refrigerator is going to consume at around 110. Our microwave oven is something which is more actually, let's keep it as 1200. Our mixer is going to, it starts from 350, so we will take it as 500. Our induction top is again a bit more, let's keep it as 1600. We have another light for the toilet. Alright, so we will have to add up all this, that gives the total wattage. But of course, we have also missed some of these sockets. So let me quickly add up all this. So we have, okay, let's say we are going to add up all these numbers and it is going to give us a total number, right? So that is going to be, for the sake of calculation, let us keep it as 12,000 watts. I didn't add it up. I'm just saying, for an example, we are going to keep it as 12,000. But what we have also missed is the number of sockets. So this is for the, we can actually categorize all these appliances into, let's say, a permanently fixed fixed appliances. Next is plug-in appliances. Right, so all that we have calculated now is almost fixed appliances. Okay, so after what we have done here is we have added all the fixed appliances. Sometimes we can even break lighting, all the lights separately, right? But we have included light also here as a fixed appliances. So now what we have missed here is the plug-in appliances. Apart from the TV, we have not included any of the sockets. So, but the socket, we don't know the wattage. We just know the, let's say living, we have a couple of sockets. One is 6 amp socket. Let's say we have one, let's say 16 amp sockets. We have one, and in kitchen we have a couple of 16 amp sockets. Right, so, but these are the numbers. So we don't know the wattage here, right? So if you again go back to the very first lecture on the basics of electricity, how do you get wattage? Wattage is nothing but voltage into current. Current is nothing but represented in amps. So when we don't have this, which we already got because of when we buy all these appliances in the package, in the specifications, we will have the wattage listed. And in India, we get a supply of 230 volts, which is here. And the cases where we don't have the wattage, but we know this. We know it is going to be 16 A6. We know this is going to get connected. So when you have a 6 amps, it is nothing but 6 into 230 volts. When you have 16 or whatever the amps we are going to have, that multiplied by 230, that is going to be your wattage in the circuit, right? So that means when you plug something more than this capacity, that branch cannot take up that load, and so that particular circuit might get short, right? So it will, in other words, if you can remember our DB, there will be a short circuit and the circuit breaker will break the circuit to prevent the overloading. Right, so this becomes a wattage. So once when we let's say 6 into 120 is 720, 16 into something around 1920. So when you add all this, so we are going to get a total number, right? Let's say, but it is very evident that we are not going to run all of these appliances at the same time. For example, when you're going to operate your heater, you're not definitely going to switch on your AC as well. When you're going to put your vacuum cleaner, you're not going to put the fan together, right? So in that assumption, we are not, it is in fact not assumption, that is very practical. We are not going to switch on all of these at the same time. So this number is not what it is, right? So that is when, so we normally take a peak load of 60, sometimes it is 80 of the entire load. So even though a circuit can handle this much, it is actually designed in such a way that it is not supposed to handle more than 80% of its capacity, right? So even you say a particular circuit is going to have this much of a voltage and 100 amps, it is going to have a wattage of 23,000, but it the appliances together shouldn't be crossing more than 80% of its total capacity. That means it can handle only 23,000 into 0.8, right? So all these together shouldn't be exceeding 80% of the total wattage because of the circuit's capacity, right? In other words, that's, that there are several thumb rules or several ways of getting this calculation, which all revolves around this assumption that all these appliances are not going to be switched on at once at the same time. But we usually take this entire number divided by some percentage, so that becomes the overall power requirement. But again, this is in wattage. So what we get billed is kilowatt hour, right? If you could remember, our government charges us for our consumption based on kilowatt hour. So whatever number we get, that divided by 1000 will give us the kilowatt unit, right? So this is how we estimate the load. And depending upon the overall peak load that we are going to have, and there are several multiplication factors there, based on that we are going to design our wires, cables which comes, and the DBs and the circuit breakers and the appliances that we have. So all of this is designed based on this particular number. Again, this attributes to the power factor and demand factor and all that we have studied in our very first module under subheading 1. So all these are interrelated. So this will give us the overall load, and accordingly we will be taking power from the government, right? And if we are an industrial based consumer, we will have this entire calculation will completely depend upon the machineries that we are going to use, and that will be the major dictating criteria in terms of this number. And so what we are going to ask from the government is also, or what the government usually classifies as such, as a particular consumer. So we have to definitely be falling under any of the categories that government has made, each of the state governments or the central government has made. So accordingly, they will give us three phase supply, single phase supply, and this 230 volts will increase if you are an industrial consumer. So based on all that, we get the overall load that we would require. So I think if this is clear, of course I have taken a simple easy example, but otherwise all that you would probably need is if you just go to any of these appliances, check their wattage in the specifications, you can try it as an exercise. You can go to any of these online shopping websites and try to find out the wattage for each of this. You can even make a tabular column with the appliance and the brand and the wattage that it consumes, and finally add up what it comes up to. So that becomes an exercise where you can play around with your load estimation for a typical house. As an exercise, you can also take up your own residence, just try to add up all the appliances that you have, look at your charger, look at your laptops, how much is the frequency, because all of it is definitely going to be AC. So this is not going to change. Your frequency is not going to change. It is always going to be 50 to 60 hertz, right? So what is definitely changing is just this, the wattage. So try that. Try calculating that. Wherever you don't have the wattage, you can just multiply your 230 with the amps, the amount of current that it is needed by a particular appliance. So try to arrive at a number which is a wattage, and then divide it by 1000, and from then you can identify how much energy you are actually using in a day, and that gives us the annual consumption as well. So with this, we have completed the series of lectures, and I thank you all for your patience, and wish you all the best for your exams. Thank you. Best of luck.